Sunshine is a 2007 Blu-ray showpiece from Danny Boyle, director of Slumdog Millionaire, 127 Hours, 28 Days Later, The Beach, you know, movies that people like the first two acts of, but generally hate how they end, you know, like this movie. Like, this episode is actually gonna be... I'll get to why the ending of this movie is brilliant in a bit, but suffice to say, I think this movie is absolutely perfect. Somewhere in the near future, the sun is dying. We don't get much more than that, and we cut in on the crew of the Icarus II. Straight away, this movie is genius. Icarus, son of the master craftsman Daedalus, who both try to escape from Crete. Icarus, given wings made of feathers and wax, attempts to fly away, but flies too close to the sun. His wings melt, and he falls and dies. And in this movie, the Earth, in major peril on the verge of death, named the first ship after him. It flies too close to the sun, and they all die. Icarus was warned before his fateful flight within mythology that hubris is a dangerous trait of humanity. So in an effort to prove this point wholesale, they named the second ship the Icarus II and tried it again. I love this movie. When we join the crew, they're already in dire straits. They can't agree on what to do, only that they need to deliver a stellar payload into the sun in an attempt to restart it. What is most relevant to the debate surrounding the movie is how deep into hard sci-fi it goes while never losing the symbolism and allusions to classic mythology. This is what drives a lot of the confusion around this movie. The Icarus II is a ship a mile long. It creates oxygen, they have a botanist on board that maintains a lab growing plants to create sustainable air, their water is recycled, they have enough food on board for 3 years, or in the case of Icarus I...
What about food? There's no way their supplies could last in 7 years.
That depends. They have stock to cover 8 people for 3 years.
That's a 4-year shortfall. That's a hell of a diet.
We don't know what happened to Icarus I. There might have been an accident or something else. There might not have been 8 people to feed.
And it gets all the little moments right. Even when the crew is at each other's throats, as they certainly would be given their eclectic expertise, every last one of them sits in stunned silence when they curve around Mercury. Every debate in this movie is played so perfectly. It pains me how little respect this film has gotten in the grand scheme of sci-fi. The human race rests on their shoulders. They are pragmatic, but rarely in agreement. This is no more clear than in the debate about changing their trajectory to stop by the Icarus I to take their payload and theoretically double their chances in succeeding in their mission.
I'd need to look at all of this pretty carefully. Very carefully. But if I had to make a guess right now, I'd say we could adjust our trajectory. We could fly straight to them.
But we're not going to do that. We have a payload to deliver to the heart of our nearest star. We're delivering that payload because that star is dying, and if it dies, we die. Everything dies. So that is our mission. There is nothing, literally, nothing more important than completing our mission. End of story.
It would, of course, be absurd to alter our trajectory to assist the crew of the Icarus I.
Even if we knew that some or even all of that crew are still alive, their lives are entirely expendable when seen in the context of our mission. However, there is something on board the Icarus I that may be worth the detour. As you pointed out, Mace, we have a payload to deliver. A payload, singular.
If we had 2 bombs, we'd have 2 chances.
You're assuming we'd be able to pilot Icarus I?
Yes.
Which is assuming that whatever stopped them completing the mission wasn't a fault or damage to the spacecraft.
Yes.
That's a lot of assumptions.
It is.
We'll have a vote.
No, 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 we won't. We're a collection of astronauts and scientists. So we're gonna make the most informed decision available to us.
Made by you, by any chance?
Made by the person best qualified to understand the complexities of the payload delivery. Our physicist.
Have I mentioned how butt-shit insane the cinematography in this movie is? Allow me to illustrate that point against the majesty of the music in the film. We'll be right back. You could hate this movie and still love it. It's just that damn beautiful. So, like Icarus, their mistakes are human. After deciding to change their course for Icarus 1, Trey, the navigator, resets their course but did not reset the shields. Which might not sound like much, but it is a catastrophic error. It is, and he knows it. They need two people to go out and see how bad the damage is.
I volunteer.
No, I volunteer.
Fine.
I volunteer, Kappa.
Man, Captain America really don't like physics. And the cast really trained for this. Outside of living together in close quarters before filming, Danny Boyle really did this to them.
Really fast, and then just stopping and gunk. They put a glove on the dashboard and it just goes like that.
You look out along the wing. We're going straight up. Then I'll turn us round. Big hell. And then look ahead over the nose.
Oh,
straight down.
God.
The ship is designed in such a way that their entire protection from the sun is the very thing that powers them. Through solar power, it gives them life. You know, like the actual sun. One small mistake has a very cascading effect. Yay, we did it! Oh, wait, no. The human drama in this movie is outstanding. Chris Evans as Mace, the engineer, comes off like an a-hole, but he's actually the voice of reason through much of the film. He's willing to sacrifice the crew to achieve their mission. After all, he did vote against going after the second payload, so he knows what needs to be done to achieve their goal, even if it means sacrificing himself. Oops, spoilers, Captain America doesn't make it. But his decision meant the captain of the ship is in danger. Searle, the doctor and psychological officer, who from the get-go is someone worshipping the sun as if it were a god, wants to know what he sees, as no human has ever seen it.
Why is he moving?
What did you see?
Searle, help him
to move! Kaneda, what did you see?
Their oxygen gone, their choices are to rendezvous with the Icarus One, or...
Harvey said there's not enough oxygen to get us to the payload delivery point, but there is. There just isn't enough oxygen to get all of us there.
Are you suggesting we let Trey kill himself?
No, and in any case, Trey wouldn't be enough. We need to lose two more.
Three out of seven, that's a lot of short straws.
How do you weigh the lives of the experts on board? Who is the most important? The movie is unapologetic in the way it asks these questions. In the grand scheme of humanity, they're all expendable. But how do you engage in that conversation? How do you tell someone they matter less to humanity's survival than you do? And unable to answer that question as a result of their hubris, which will from here on out be referred to simply as humanity, they board the Icarus One, finding it a tomb of dust. This is where the movie takes a turn and starts to lose people. It becomes a horror movie. Everything on the boat seems fine, but it isn't. There's a transmission from the captain of the Icarus One, and he's a little out of it. P.S. Chris Evans is right. He's been right the whole time. He'll die being right. He'll die because he's right.
In the face of this, we are dust, nothing more. And through this dust, we will return.
The Icarus One was sabotaged. By boarding it, they were sabotaged. They have no airlock. Four men, one spacesuit. They think they're fighting God. Each man without a suit tears off some mylar protection in an effort to brave themselves against the cold vacuum of space. Searle stays behind. He meets the god he's wanted to the whole time. And now we're down to this. This movie is dark. Upliftingly dark, I guess, but dark in a way that few films are. They vote to kill a man to save the world, but the man is smart enough to know that he's already dead, so he does it himself. The man who made the mistake in the first place. The men fight. The women bring calm, conscious reasoning to the conversation.
Esla, we need to limit our exertions.
But they're in trouble. oxygen for 4 crew members, but for some reason there's 5. They thought they were fighting God. Helios, the Greek god, drove a chariot across the sky with the sun pulled behind it. The sun is literally our god. It gave us life, and it sustains it. This movie is misunderstood because, like the hubris of our kind, if we worship a god, we cannot forget its devil. And when God is dying, the devil has all control. That's what this movie is about. It's hard science fiction to explain our own hubris back to us. Who are we to fight extinction? Who are we to believe that science can defeat our gods? What can we sacrifice if we save God? If we kill the devil, are we not then God ourselves? Or is that the most uplifting thing of all? We alone can save ourselves. 8 people who all got on the ship for different reasons. The mission was to save everyone except themselves. And to do it, one man had to fly across the surface of the sun. But unlike Icarus, he did not fall. For it was science that saved him. And in turn, he saved God and mankind.
It takes 8 minutes for light to travel from sun to earth, which means you'll know we've succeeded about 8 minutes after we deliver the payload. All you have to do is look out for a little extra brightness in the sky. So if you wake up one morning and it's a particularly beautiful day, you'll know we made it.
That's how I live my life, one crevice at a time. My Fast and Furious bus joke.
Everyone has their own Fast and Furious butt. What's yours? Hashtag Fast Furious Butts.
Fast Furious Butt J.